Okay, colleagues, if we could move on to the next item of business, which is a members' business debate on motion 7546 in the name of Ruth Maguire on Cervical Cancer Prevention Week. Debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I call on Ruth Maguire to open the debate for around 7 minutes. Ms. Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a privilege to open this debate on cervical cancer prevention week, but I'll confess to not feeling entirely comfortable. I didn't get into politics to talk about myself, and whilst being open about my diagnosis in 2021 may have inadvertently raised some awareness, I have to say that my motivation for doing so was so that I could properly take time out of the public eye to give treatment the best chance. I've said it before, but I'd like to put on record again my thanks to my team, Lynn and Karen, for their support, and to constituents in Cunningham South for the understanding and well wishes that they sent. Now, after a year back at work, it felt like an okay time to share some of my story. I am grateful to the Sunday Post for helping me to do that, and to Tracy Bryce for the kindness and respect she showed me in her reporting. I fully understand that the experience I had of diagnosis and then life-saving treatment for cervical cancer will not have been the same as other women's. And I'm acutely aware of just how lucky I was to have all the resources, support and love that I needed to get well. But there is one thing I think I can confidently say on behalf of women who've experienced cervical cancer. And it's also the reason why this year I'm speaking up and supporting Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust in their biggest ever campaign. And that thing is that we wouldn't want anyone else to go through what we did. Effective treatment, although it's life-saving, can be life-changing and long-lasting. If cervical cancer is something that we can prevent, end and eradicate, then we must. Joe's Cervical Trust are calling for government commitments to elimination with strategies to ensure that no one is missed out or left behind. In screening and immunisation, we have powerful tools to do just that. In my local area health board, Ayrshire and Arran cervical screening coverage is 71.7%. The latest coverage for Scotland is 69.3%. with women in our most deprived areas being least likely to take part in screening. There'll be a number of reasons why women don't attend when invited, and it's really important that we understand so we can take action to address that. There might be practical considerations. Time off work can be difficult for some people, particularly those in precarious and low-paid employment. Likewise, travel, the cost or time to get there. Generally, women might feel apprehensive or uncomfortable about the test itself. And for one in three women, survivors of sexual violence, it can be particularly difficult. I'd like them to know that they're not alone. The Eve Appeal has a fantastic guide for survivors of rape, sexual assault and sexual abuse, with tips for the appointment itself and communicating needs to healthcare professionals. Crucially, they also have a guide for healthcare professionals, and I would commend it to all those who are interested in providing that essential trauma aware support to women. A Ferret article published in January on January 22nd found 440,000 eligible for cervical screening in 2020-2021 hadn't had a smear test in the last 3 to 5 years. Those most likely to miss screening were aged 25 to 29, along with, as I mentioned before, those in deprived areas. And there are wider issues around inequality to deal with health. My own experience of accessing tests and treatment made me acutely aware of just how challenging it would be if I didn't have someone to run me there, if I didn't have a job where I could, to a certain extent, manage my own diary and schedule things in. I'd be very keen to hear from the Minister what work is being done by government to understand and address the inequalities in uptake. And I think this won't just be helpful for cervical cancer, for all cancer screening and treatment, but for all areas of health. Presiding Officer, I want to thank colleagues who supported this motion. I look forward to hearing contributions from colleagues this evening. I'd also like to thank everyone who attended the event sponsored by myself and Carol Mochan, MSP, with Joe's Cervical Trust. It was really good to see so many local press releases going out and awareness being raised locally around the country. I'd like to urge the Scottish Government to continue on the path to elimination. I know that there is good news to tell here in Scotland. We need to press forward and keep going on with that. I also think we need to redouble our efforts, re-inequality. It will save lives. And to individual women and indeed everyone, I want to say, immunise your young people. To women, attend your screenings when invited. Crucially, don't ignore symptoms or bleeding that are different for you. It could save your life. Presiding Officer, thank you.
Thank you very much, and congratulations, Ms. Maguire. We move to the open debate. Given that unusually we have two members' debates this evening, I'd be grateful if members could stick to their speaking allocation so that we're not concluding too late this evening. I start by calling Tess White, to be followed by Emma Harper. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. White.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank Ruth Maguire for securing the parliamentary time for such an important debate. Tragically, cancer is a major cause of death in Scotland, and all of us have likely been touched in some way by its impact. And I know all of us long for the day it's eliminated for good. It's a sobering thought that two women in the UK died today from cervical cancer. Another nine women and their families are coming to terms this evening with a diagnosis of cervical cancer. Some are mums, some face the devastating prospect of losing their fertility as part of their treatment. But there is hope, and that is through the cervical screening programme and the HPV vaccination programme. And on the latter, I was struck by figures reported by Joe's Trust that cases of cervical cancer have fallen by 97% amongst women in their 20s due to the vaccine. And in Scotland, I understand uptake rates of the first dose of HPV have consistently exceeded 90%, as Ruth says, and that is to be welcomed. But uptake levels for surgical screening are not as high, as has just been pointed out, and that is where improvement is most needed. Public Health Scotland data is only available for the period up to 31st of March 2021. But it shows an uptake rate for cervical screening was 69.3% amongst eligible women. And worryingly, as Ruth Maguire says, the uptake has declined in recent years and is especially low amongst women aged between 25 and 29. Ruth also flagged the multiple barriers to accessing a screening appointment. Anxiety and embarrassment can mean that women delay or decide not to do it. Experience of sexual trauma, as Ruth Maguire pointed out, can also prevent women from being screened, while there are issues of accessibility for women with a disability. Pain and fear of the result can also act as obstacles. We must do everything we can to address these barriers, and it's important that we see leadership at the highest levels. I know Joe's Trust and other charities were vocal in their calls for the urgent appointment of a women's health champion in Scotland. And bizarrely, this role was promised by the SNP as a medium-term action as part of the Women's Health Plan, which itself is only intended to cover the period 2021 to 2024. I'm pleased to see the position has now been filled by Professor Anna Glazier, but like many others, I was deeply frustrated by the time lost over the prolonged appointment process. I know Professor Glazier is keen to focus her work on the menopause, endometriosis and polycystic ovary syndrome. I hope too that she will work with health boards and charities to improve cervical screening uptake and to explore new ways to facilitate this process. In the meantime, Presiding Officer, I urge all eligible women to please, please book a cervical screening appointment when the letter arrives. It could save your life. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. White. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Jackie Bailey. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I congratulate my colleague Ruth Maguire on securing this debate and on her very powerful opening speech. And I know she's sitting right behind me. Presiding Officer, we know that the human papillomavirus HPV vaccine it helps protect people from HPV-related cancers, including cervical cancer. And in the first study of its kind funded by Cancer Research UK, rates of cervical cancer in women in their 20s who were affected, who were offered the bivalent Cervarix HPV vaccine at age 12 to 13 in England were 87% lower than those who did not receive the vaccine. This is why it's so essential to vaccinate all those who are eligible so that we can make sure we can improve uptake and they can receive their vaccine. The HPV immunisation statistics for Scotland for the school year 2021 to 2022 show that HPV vaccine coverage has increased in 2021 to 2022 compared with the previous year. But the numbers are not equivalent to pre-pandemic levels in all areas, and there is still significant regional and local variation. Coverage of the first dose of HPV vaccine for S1 pupils increased in 2021-22, with overall coverage rates of 73.5% compared to 52.1% in 2020-2021. So by the end of S2, 86.4% of females had received their first dose. So while these statistics are welcome, I would ask the Minister to ensure that the Scottish Government is doing all it can to enable HPV vaccine take-up. Presiding Officer, I want to touch on screening also. We know that screening is key to both preventing cancers developing more widely as well as detecting cancers at an early stage when treatment is more likely to be successful. Cervical screening aims to identify whether a person is at a higher risk of developing cervical cell changes or cervical cancer, enabling people to access treatment more quickly. And self-sampling as part of the screening for HPV is one of the areas that I've been pursuing. I know the Scottish Government is pursuing this also. In the last session of Parliament, I was made aware that 6,000 women had defaulted on their invitation to attend their screening smear test in Dumfries and Galloway. 6,000 women were being missed on their smear test screening. So I met with Drs. William Forson and Heather Curry, who, along with their team, were attempting to improve screening numbers by introducing a self-sampling approach that they wanted to test the effectiveness in addressing the women who were failing to accept and attend their invite to screening. This has now been picked up by the government, I'm pleased to hear, and the benefits of self-sampling mean that home tests away from clinics and GP practice, offering people a choice of place, Presiding Officer, no interruption to work, no travel to appointment needed, or other barriers to take up of cervical screening. And we've heard already that some women do find intimate examination of having a smear test very difficult, painful, distressing and embarrassing. So self-sampling for HPV is one way to help increase screening uptake, especially for women in remote island and rural areas like my South Scotland region. I was one of the defaulters contacted by NHS Dumfries and Galloway, and I did have the opportunity to take part in the self-test trial. So I'd be grateful if the Minister could provide an update on the status of home sampling and whether there are any findings about its success as we move forward. Presiding Officer, during lockdown, I attended Joe's Cervical Cancer online meeting with women who were part of the Wigtonshire Women in Charity group. And the presentation was excellent. The Joe's Trust representatives were absolutely fantastic. And they basically supported continuing to engage and support women to take up their screening. And I also encourage women to do the same. And again, I thank Ruth Maguire for securing this debate, and I look forward to the Minister's response.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. I now call Jackie Bailey to be followed by Gillian Martin, up to 4 minutes.
Let me begin by thanking Ruth Maguire for securing this important debate and thank her for sharing her experience. Can I also take this opportunity to commend the work of Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust? Presiding Officer, let me apologise to the Chamber as I have to leave early to chair a cross-party group, and I am grateful to you for permission to do so. I believe that members across the Chamber are united in the belief that cervical cancer can and should be beaten once and for all. But statistics show we are unfortunately going backwards when it comes to ending this disease. The rollout of self-sampling is too slow. Those with abnormal smear tests face waits of a year for colposcopy appointments, whilst inequalities for women in the poorest communities continue to rise. The World Health Organization calls for 70% of women globally to be screened regularly for cervical cancer. But according to Public Health Scotland, women from the most deprived areas of the country are less likely to take part, with uptake reaching only 63%. And 45% of women, as we've heard, between ages 25 and 29, have not attended a screening at all, which suggests that younger women are less likely to come forward for their smear test. So there are several reasons why that might be happening. It can be down to an experience of trauma, concern around pain, or inaccessible GP practices, or even a lack of information and time. That is why Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust have asked the Scottish Government to roll out new tests like HPV self-sampling. The Trust surveyed over 800 professionals working in and alongside cancer prevention, and 70% said they thought that HPV self-sampling was the biggest opportunity to eliminate cervical cancer in the UK. And while it's important to ensure that clinician-led screening is still encouraged and supported, allowing for self-sampling will certainly begin to address the low numbers of people coming forward. But tackling cervical cancer will not happen by addressing screening uptake alone. The process for addressing abnormalities and examining the cervix in the aftermath of a smear test is extremely important, and stats show that women are being failed here when it matters most. Waits for follow-up colposcopies in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde continue to soar. And during Cervical Cancer Awareness Week, I raised the case of my constituent who had a smear test in February 2022, which showed abnormal cells. She had to wait a year for the follow-up colposcopy. And I received a letter from the Cabinet Secretary wishing her well for an appointment at the end of January, which was cancelled. We really need to do better for women. And my constituent told me, it's been really tough on my mental health. I was left questioning if the delay would have a detrimental outcome for me. FOIs have revealed that the longest wait for a colposcopy across NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde is currently 48 weeks. In comparison, in neighbouring Lanarkshire, over the past 6 months, no one has had to wait more than 10 weeks for a colposcopy. And in NHS Lothian, the second biggest health board in Scotland, the average wait was just short of 9 weeks. So there's a real postcode lottery in people, women's experience across Scotland. And the figures for Greater Glasgow and Clyde are shocking, and actually far worse than the rest of the country. And this is an area where health inequalities are worsening and should be addressed as a matter of urgency. So cervical cancer is a treatable disease. I welcome the improvement in HPV vaccination, but we need to do more. And the Scottish Government must tackle screening inequalities and screening uptake, fund further research and address wait times for colposcopies, particularly in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. Only then can we hope to beat cervical cancer once and for all.
Thank you, Ms. Bailey. I now call Gillian Martin to be followed by Sharon Dowie for up to 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank Ruth Maguire for leading the debate and securing it. And anyone who knows Ms. Maguire will know that, no, she doesn't like to talk about her own situation and her work. And I'm under no doubt of what it's taken for her to talk about the disease that she's had to deal with in this public forum. But thank you for that. Because as everything Ruth Maguire does, it's about helping other women. That's just what she does. And I'd like to assist her in that in a small way by outlining what women should be looking for. When it comes to cervical cancer, knowledge is power. So I'm very glad for the opportunity to help spread awareness and encourage others to take the necessary steps towards reducing their risk for this preventable disease. Cervical cancer is preventable, and it can be treatable if found early enough. But those symptoms can mask themselves as something else that can be brushed off as the kind of curveballs that our reproductive systems throw us women from time to time, not least in your 40s and your 50s. And not everyone will show symptoms, but it's still crucial to be aware of them. So I'd like to highlight them because I do feel that sometimes when we do these types of debates, even if one person is watching the recording of it, on Facebook afterwards, or one person's watching it live and actually goes and takes up that smear test invitation, it's worth it. So here's some symptoms that could be a sign. Vaginal bleeding that's unusual for you. It could be during or after sex, between your periods or after the menopause, just having heavier periods than usual. Any changes to discharge from your vagina? Pain during sex, pain in your lower back, between your hip bones or in your lower abdomen. And these symptoms, they can be caused by other conditions like fibroids or endometriosis. So if you've got that, you may just pass them off as being part and parcel of that. But it is important to get checked by a GP if the symptoms change or get worse. And I'd also like to emphasise that some of these symptoms can be present in women who are about to go through the menopause or are going through the menopause. Women around the age of 40 or older might experience pain or unusual bleeding, and this assumes the menopause. And that's the thing about us women, we put up with quite a lot with our bodies. You know, we get used to a certain amount of pain, we get used to a certain amount of discomfort, then we often just struggle on and just pass it off. Don't do that, because you need to find out what's really going on. But sometimes there are no symptoms, and that's why screening is important, particularly in detecting any abnormalities as early as possible. And while we've taken steps in the right direction to prevent cervical cancer in Scotland, I do share others' concerns for the uptake on screening invitations. It's been mentioned by others, around 1 in 3 women won't take up the invitation for screening, but the facts don't lie. Every week in Scotland, around 6 women will learn they have cervical cancer. It's the most common cancer in women between 25 and 35 years old, and that screening might prevent you having to deal with this disease. But I would like to end with some good news. The good news, item number one, my friend Ruth McGuire is back in action after her treatment, and thank goodness for that. Number two, in the future, the disease that she had can be easily become one of the rarest, with all our daughters having had the HPV vaccination. Cervical cancer may one day be eradicated, but it won't go away on its own. We've got to make sure we get our daughters vaccinated. We've got to make sure we take up those screening invitations. But my thanks goes to Ruth McGuire for today's debate and for bringing Joe's Trust into the Parliament a couple of weeks ago, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms. Thornton. I now call Shannon Dowie to be followed by Monica Lennon. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would like to thank Ruth McGuire for securing this important debate today. As a largely preventable disease, we are fortunate to live in a time when we have access to early detection and prevention strategies for cervical cancer. The HPV vaccine was approved in 80 countries by 2007, and as of October 2019, 100 countries worldwide vaccinated against HPV as part of the regular vaccine schedule. The uptake of the vaccine in Scotland is about 84%. This is an incredible achievement. And Scottish data has shown that diagnoses of cervical cell changes decreased by 89% in people vaccinated against HPV, but we still need to do more. The cervical screening programme is a powerful tool to detect cell changes prior to them becoming cancerous, and that is where we need to see improvement. It is worrying to hear that 1 in 3 women do not take up the screening invite. To improve these numbers, we must identify and address the barriers people are faced with. Fear of the procedure itself, embarrassment, and lack of knowledge about the implications of smear results undoubtedly play a role in individuals avoiding or delaying their smear invitations. This is compounded by the current pressures facing the NHS, causing a lack of appointments and often long waits. Unfortunately, the more disadvantaged groups of our society are again worse affected. We know that people with learning or physical disabilities and individuals from disadvantaged backgrounds are less likely to attend smear appointments. There is already excellent work being done to tackle these problems. Strategies such as self-sampling programmes to enable at-home testing show promising results. They allow those for whom traditional methods of screening may be unsuitable to have the option to get checked. The NHS and relevant charities already do a fantastic job. Their awareness campaigns, staff screening clinics, and online resources continue to help increase awareness and push towards the WHO global strategy for cervical cancer elimination. We have the tools and knowledge to eradicate the disease, but the reality is that two women in the UK continue to lose their lives every day from cervical cancer. Cancer is something that affects all of us, whether personally or through someone close to us. Cervical cancer is one of the few cancers that we currently have the ability to detect and treat at such an early stage. That's why we need to push for the change that will make this disease a less common reality for women not only in Ayrshire, Scotland, but around the world. I would like to encourage all women to take up their cervical screening invites. Your health is important, and this simple procedure, taken at the right time, could make all the difference. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I want to urge everyone to continue speaking about this important topic and, when invited, take up your offers for vaccination and screening. They are quick steps that could literally save your life. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Dowie. I now call Monica Lennon to be followed by Siobhan Brown. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sorry, my throat's been struggling all day, so I'll try and keep this brief. I want to join colleagues in paying tribute to Ruth Maguire, to thank her for tabling the motion and making this debate possible, but for speaking about something that is deeply personal to her. And I think those of us who know Ruth know that she is a modest person and is feeling uncomfortable about doing this. But we do thank her for putting herself out there and putting her pain and experience out there. And I know that her family and friends and loved ones who will be listening and watching will be feeling very proud of her. And we're all glad that she is back in the Parliament. I was very struck by something that Ruth Maguire said in her interview with the Sunday Post, when she said, "I didn't have time to have cancer." And that just really stopped me in my tracks that Sunday morning when I read that. And I think that's a theme in today's debate, but also in the recent event that happened in Parliament. I wasn't able to attend due to a funeral, but I did chair the cross-party group on women's health, where we heard again from another woman about her experience, her reality, and that issue about not having the time, because as women, we so often put ourselves at the back of the queue. We're juggling work, we're juggling childcare, caring responsibilities, and so much more. So that issue, that theme about time, I think we all have to get real, because life is short and it is precious and we have to look after ourselves. So I'm really glad that Ruth had made that point in her interview. The other woman I want to speak about in my brief remarks is Emma Keyes, who's a constituent of mine. Emma's a young mum. She's now 31. She's got three children. She's a very busy, energetic young woman, and those of us who've met Emma are inspired by her. So I want to remind the Minister, because I know the Minister gave her time to meet with Emma, but to let the Minister know that Emma hasn't gone away. She's a survivor, but she's very much fighting to make sure that, as others have said today, that we get there in terms of not just talking about elimination strategy, but we really pick up the pace on this. So Emma just wants to remind the Parliament and the Government of her story. And she said, and I'll quote, "After being diagnosed with cervical cancer and understanding this is a preventable cancer, it sickens me that other women have to go through this. If we get the right testing implemented, that increases uptake and fewer women will have to hear those dreaded words, 'You have cervical cancer.' Fewer women will have to face harsh treatments resulting in fertility loss," which was Emma's experience. And Emma goes on, "HPV home testing kits give us a better chance to treat a precancerous stage as opposed to this horrible cancer diagnosis for a younger age group. If we can increase the uptake with HPV home testing, as has been shown in the trials, then why wouldn't we roll this out sooner? This will literally save women's lives and take away the many barriers that come along with smear testing." So that's what Emma had to say. So like others, I'm really keen to hear from the Minister about where we've got to following the trials in Dumfries and Galloway, how we can speed this out and how we can make sure that whether it's in Parliament, Government or in our own lives, that we make the time to treat this seriously and use all the tools at our disposal to eliminate cervical cancer. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Lennon. And I call Siobhan Brown to be followed by Carol Morgan. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Brown.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to my colleague Ruth Maguire for bringing this important debate to the Chamber this evening. And can I also commend Ruth, who recently also hosted a drop-in event for Parliament for Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust and highlighting the End of Cervical Cancer campaign. Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust was set up by James Maxwell in memory of his wife Jo, who died from cervical cancer at the age of 40 in 1999. And following Joe's diagnosis in 1995, Joe and James had difficulty finding good information about every aspect of cervical cancer, and it was their hope that one day everyone would have easy access to the best and most up-to-date information. And most importantly for Joe, it was her wish that women affected by cervical cancer would have the opportunity to communicate with others facing similar challenges. And it's encouraging, over 20 years on, Joe's legacy still lives on, but there's still work to be done. Funding from the Scottish Government's Screening Inequality Fund in 2022 enables a charity to offer training, information and support to health boards in Scotland to address inequalities in cervical screening uptake. And as we've already heard, sadly, women from the most deprived areas are less likely to take part in screening, with uptake only 63% compared to 74% in the least deprived areas. And as we know, younger women are also less likely to attend screening, particularly those aged between 25 and 29. So no woman should be left behind when it comes to cervical screening. I'm going to mention tonight somebody that we're all aware of from many years ago, and it's Jade Goody effect on cervical cancer screening. The reality TV star lost her life to cervical cancer in 2009. Her battle was a very public battle, with her diagnosis coming 2 days after she was set to appear in the Indian version of Big Brother in August 2008. And she had a test before her appearance because her symptoms included pain in her legs and heavy bleeding. And in September of that year, her cancer was deemed life-threatening, and she had a radical hysterectomy and started chemotherapy and radiotherapy. And there was also a documentary at the time called Jade's Cancer Battle, which was aired on television. She died on the 22nd of March 2009, and she was only 27 and the mother of two young boys. Her legacy, however, would prove to be something powerful at the time. And if we take a step back, when it was first announced that her cancer was terminal, medical authorities across the whole of the UK announced a surge in requests from women, particularly young women, for cervical screening. Jade Goody did have the ability to reach women that some campaigns and awareness drives just could not, and her fight brought home the importance of a cervical smear test, and her legacy did save lives. Sadly, as time's gone on, that effect has worn off, and it's also so important why we have to continue to highlight the importance. It's important that women, young and old, know the signs and symptoms of cervical cancer and the importance of screening when offered. We need to have the conversation continue, and telling personal stories can be really difficult, and I applaud the bravery of everybody keeping the conversation alive. If it saves one life, it has been worth it. And for some of the conversation, the conversation will be a reminder, but for younger women, it might be a new conversation. So to everyone, women who may listen to this, when the smear test letter comes through your door, please, please ensure that you make your appointment. Yes, it can be embarrassing. Yes, it can be slightly uncomfortable, but it's over in 10 minutes and it could save your life. 1 in 3 women don't attend their smear test, and we must change this. It needs to change if we are going to save lives. So let me tell you the symptoms again. Unusual bleeding, pain in your back, your hip, your legs, and just look out for out of the ordinary system symptoms. As previous speakers have mentioned, each year in Scotland, 323 women are diagnosed with cervical cancer and 95 women lose their lives. 93% of cervical cancers are preventable through screening. It just has to be caught in time. So when the letter appears, again, I say, please don't ignore it. Please take time to book your screening because it could save your life. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Brown. I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Carol Mochan, who joins us online. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer.
And can I also thank Ruth Maguire for bringing this important debate to the Chamber today? And I'm sorry I'm not in the Chamber, but at home. I just want to make a short contribution because I know that we do have a lot of business to get through today. My first point is that it was an absolute honour to co-host with Ruth Maguire the drop-in event for MSPs with Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust celebrating the Cervical Cancer Prevention Week. It was crucial that members had the opportunity to learn of statistics in their own region relating to cervical cancer, HPV vaccine availability and uptake, as well as the general work of Joe's Trust and the work that they do in raising awareness right across Scotland. The Deputy Presiding Officer, the report published by Joe's Trust last month titled We Can End Cervical Cancer does raise some concerning points, notably highlighting that incidence rate in Scotland per 100,000 is higher than in any other part of the United Kingdom and over three times higher than the WHO, the WHO target. And so I think it is important that we are taking this very, very seriously. It also indicates, as we've heard from many of the speakers, that those in the most deprived areas are by quite some distance, less likely to attend screening appointments, which brings more concern when Joe's Trust tell us 50% of instances of cervical cancer in the UK are women who have never been screened. So yet again, we see that health inequalities in Scotland are deep and they're divisive. And I bring to the Chamber quite a lot the point that they are taking lives. So this is why I have repeatedly asked the Minister about self-sampling, and I'm really pleased tonight that so many of the members have raised it, because we know that it is thought to be one of the most important among the five top priorities in terms of screening, that screening programmes across the UK. It's been indicated that that's the level that the cancer charities feel it could help with. So just to close, I also wanted to ask the Minister about the pilot project in Ayrshire and Arran for people with physical disabilities, because again, we have spoken about the fact that a health inequality exists there for women with a physical disability. And I'm hoping to go and visit the service there with Joe's Trust. And I hope that the Minister will see that as an important step in making sure that we get that right for those women. So as I say, in the interest of time, I'll close there. Thank everybody for their contributions. Thank Ruth Maguire again and the Minister for responding.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mochan. I now invite Marie Todd to respond to the debate. Minister, up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. I want to thank my good friend and colleague, Ruth Maguire, for raising this motion in the Chamber today and for sharing her personal experience, and also for my colleagues' important contributions. Raising awareness of cervical cancer prevention is absolutely crucial if we are truly to achieve prevention of this disease. It's a unique and exciting opportunity to entirely eradicate a cancer that affects so many, and I am determined we do all that we can to achieve this. There's a few different aspects that work together to help us in preventing cervical cancer, and as outlined in the motion, the World Health Organization has identified three key targets which will move us towards eliminating this disease. And I'm working very closely with my officials in progressing work in relation to the WHO targets with regards to screening, HPV vaccine and treatment. Firstly, cervical screening is a key element to ensure those who are developing cancer are treated as early as possible, whether that be at an early stage of cancer or even identifying precancerous cells. As I often reiterate, this is the one screening test that catches cancer before it's even cancer. For screening, the World Health Organization target states that 70% of women screened using a high-performance test by the age of 35 and again by the age of 45. Now, in Scotland, overall screening uptake is consistently above 70% in women in the 35 to 44 and 45 to 49 age group. But screening uptake is below 70% in younger age groups, and as many have mentioned, in women in the two most deprived SIMD quintiles. So that's not good enough. across all of the World Health Organization targets, it's not enough for us just to meet these at a general population level, but we have to work to ensure that we do so for all of our population. One of my top priorities for the screening programme is to continue to increase overall uptake, but also to reduce inequalities. And as we all know, the factors that drive inequality are complex and they defy easy solutions, but I'm passionately committed to closing the gap, and so too is the screening community in Scotland. We've awarded £456,000 to Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust to support their vital campaign work on cancer, and that includes work to raise awareness of the screening benefits and to tackle and understand key issues around access and uptake. And this month we've worked with Public Health Scotland to support other partners to promote Cervical Cancer Prevention Week. For all the cancer screening programmes, we've committed £2 million over the last 2 years to take a more sustainable and systematic approach to reducing inequalities. And that's empowered health boards to take action at a local level to meet the needs of specific populations. Nationally, it supported improvement in communications with screening participants and the collection and analysis of data so that interventions can be better tailored for maximum impact. These inequalities are driven by complex factors, and work's also ongoing to develop a long-term strategy to address these. Now, in preparation for a UK National Screening Committee recommendation, all the members in the Chamber will be aware that there has been no recommendation yet from the UK National Screening Committee on cervical self-sampling. But we in Scotland continue to lay the groundwork for introducing cervical self-sampling, which has the potential to remove some of the barriers which can deter people from attending screening. Now, it's a complex undertaking, and we are awaiting, not very patiently, I agree, both consensus on the most appropriate test and how to use it, and I see a lot of potential benefits to it. One very powerful example of this is victims of sexual violence, who absolutely could benefit from this in the safe environment of their own home. And we are doing all that we can to ensure that we can respond quickly to the NSC advice once it publishes. Of course, the cervical self-screening isn't the entire solution. So we already have self-screening or home screening kits for bowel cancer, and we don't get 100% participation. So it is one very important step forward, but it's not the entirety. Key findings for cervical screening as a result of the Inequalities Project found that methods that were successful in increasing uptake were using locations that feel safe, familiar, convenient. Now, that's an obvious for self-screening. Targeting defaulters, though, which is what self-sampling pilots are looking to do, is an important part of that work. And flexibility in delivery. So if we continue with sampling cervical screening at GP practices, what about providing out-of-hours clinics? In Forth Valley, they did an interesting...
Monica Lennon.
Thank you. Just picking up those themes around inequality and the need for flexibility, we hear a lot from women who have real trouble having the conversation with their employer, their manager, getting time off work. And I just wonder what discussions the Minister and Government are having with employers and trade unions about how we can remind people of fair work principles and to make sure that, particularly for those women who are in precarious work, and low-paid work, that they're not facing additional barriers, because that's the reality for people in our communities.
Minister.
So, absolutely, and I thank the member for that intervention, and I thank her for raising awareness of that issue, as well as raising awareness amongst employers and trade unions and things. Forth Valley did this interesting project where they sent reminder letters to 8,000 women for cervical screening, gave them the option of booking an evening or a day appointment, and 282 women attended in total, prompted by these letters. 80% of those were from areas of higher deprivation, so that increase in flexibility is absolutely vital. And as a result of that, a few practices are now offering regular screening clinics as a matter of course. The cervical screening toolkit aims to address falling attendance rates and a lack of understanding of cervical cancer. And the toolkit highlights the importance of vaccine and is leading with new digital assets and raising awareness of HPV and cervical screening testing as the benefits to do so. The HPV vaccine, well, the World Health Organization sets a target of 90% of girls to be fully vaccinated by the age of 15, in line with the JCV advice. The HPV vaccine programme was introduced for girls in Scotland in 2008, 1st September. 1st of January this year, a new single dose schedule was introduced, and I'm absolutely certain that reducing the complexity of the dose schedule will increase the uptake. So eligible for a single dose vaccine up to your 25th birthday. And we envisage that that programme change will increase the number of people coming forward and completing their vaccine schedule, because it will remove that requirement to be recalled to have a second one and to manage follow-up appointments. And in fact, the one-dose HPV vaccine coverage is currently over 91.5% for girls in S4, which will, from 1st January this year, be considered to be a completed course of HPV. Prevention is the main aim, but it's really important that we ensure our diagnostics and treatment pathways are maintained for those who need it. We know that the earlier cancer is diagnosed, the easier it is to treat and even cure, which is why we continue to invest in our Detect Cancer Early programme. In response to the issues that Jackie Bailey raised, the access to colposcopy, urgent cases do continue to be prioritised and completed within 4 and 5 weeks, but I absolutely agree that it's not good enough. The Health Board are recognising the anxiety that the long wait is causing, and they're taking on locums to tackle the backlog. As we've heard this evening, the Scottish Government, along with all of us here, are absolutely committed to encourage those who are eligible for cervical screening to engage with the screening programme. Now, I want to be clear. If anyone has any symptoms or suspicion of cancer, they should get checked. To support Cervical Cancer Prevention Week, we've run social content on the Scottish Government's We See channels throughout the week, and I want to thank all of our partners that help us in achieving these goals. We're going to continue to work together to further improve our awareness of cervical cancer and increase participation in cervical screening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate. It's time to move on to the next item. There'll be a brief pause while front benches change, and we'll move on to the next item of business.